If you enjoy watching Common Ground online, please consider making a tax-deductible donation at lptv.org. Lakeland Public Television presents Common Ground, brought to you by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and the citizens of Minnesota. Common Ground, I'm your host, Scott Knudsen. In this two-segment episode, author Michael Meuers lends insight into his book detailing the teachings of the late Red Lake elder, Larry Stillday. Then Hereditary Chief Darwin Sumner takes an exchange student from Madrid, Spain fishing on an ideal summer day.
My name is Michael Meuers, and I have written a book about the words and teachings of Larry Stillday, whose Indian name was Gichimaingan, which means Big Wolf. He was a teacher, a healer, and a spiritual and cultural advisor for the Red Lake Band of Chippewa Indians from the community of Obashing, or as many people know it better as Panema. The title of the book is Road to Panema. And the subtitle is The Teachings of Larry Stillday. Well, I've been working for Red Lake as a public relations person for just over 20 years. And about 6 or 7 years ago, I met a fellow by the name of Larry Stillday, who was a cultural and spiritual elder leader from the Red Lake Reservation. He'd been gone for many years and then came back, and his family were spiritual leaders at Red Lake from Panema, where most of them come from. And he had a philosophy about him that I found unusual in the sense that he wasn't talking to just Indians. He was talking to whites, all the colors of the medicine wheel, red, yellow, black, and white. And that struck me as unusual. I think, you know, that it probably had something to do with the time that he spent in Vietnam. He was in Vietnam during the Vietnam War. He would be now 72 years old if he were still alive. He also went through a period of, I'm not speaking out of school here, he was also, I went through a period of alcoholism. Spent some time in Louisiana, married a Louisiana belle, moved back home and started studying under a former spiritual leader, Tom Stillday, who was I believe, an uncle of his. And as Tommy started getting sick, he would ask Larry to take over his cultural spiritual duties. For an example, powwows is where he first started out. He just had this different way. He was a teacher somehow. He was more than just a person to give advice on cultural and spiritual things. He was a teacher and a healer.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Naboob.
Oh, Naboob.
Naboob.
Soup. Naboob, you give me some again.
The first time that I recall noticing something really different about him and his approach to teaching, he had what he called a well-briety event, which is a way of approaching alcohol recovery, addictive recovery. And he had this well-briety event down at the waterfront here in Bemidji. Or as he would say, Bemidji Gamag. He also got the mayor at the time to sign a proclamation making that particular day well-briety day in Bemidji. And he invited everybody to come. And it didn't matter what color, white or red or black or brown or yellow, you know, please come to this. And it seemed unusual because I don't recall ever having an Indian event in Bemidji before that. I never recall it anyway. So I was attracted to that, and so I started following him around because with my job as public relations person, it was my job to attend many of these events that he would be the spiritual and cultural advisor for. And then he would say these things that were almost poetic, Chief Seattle-like, you know, if people are familiar with the words of Chief Seattle. And there was a poetry about them. He had a way of forming an argument that built up, and also the way he chose his words. Unlike me, who has a tendency to be a little chatty, he would get his point across in just a couple of sentences. It was really impressive. I can think of one time we were out at the Panema Roundhouse, and we've been doing youth camps for cultural and language out there, and it's way in the backwoods of Panema at a very special, sacred place. After this thing was over, there's 50, 60 rambunctious kids between the ages of all 6 and 12 or 13. And at the end of this thing, he started to speak, and the kids just quieted. It was just amazing. And he lectured the elders there, the older people, the language people and the elders, and he said, quit teaching these kids that they've lost something. They haven't lost anything. Their culture and their language is contained in the land. I don't know, he just said those kinds of things, that we haven't lost anything. Nobody is coming from across the sea anymore to hurt your children. We need to rediscover who ourselves in order to heal. And he'd talk about balance in your life, the emotional and mental and spiritual and physical, saying they're integrated, they're all one. And in order to be a successful human being, you have to balance all those aspects of your life. If I claim this property here as my land, if I claim this as my land, it seems to me that I also claim its history. And there's so many people in the city of Bemidji that think that history started in Bemidji in 1895. And the people in Minnesota think that history started in 1858. And the United States thinks that history started in 1976, and the pilgrims before them, and Columbus, good Lord, before them, you know, that's when history began. But there were people here for thousands and thousands of years, and they had a culture, and they had a language, and I might add that the Ojibwe language is probably one of the most complex languages in the world. You can conjugate verbs 64 times, 128 times you can conjugate verbs. It's just incredible, the language. I don't expect to ever learn it, but I try. But at any rate, if we claim this is our land, then we also claim its history, all of its history. And if we claim that history, I think that we also should respect and maybe even celebrate the culture of the indigenous peoples of this land. They've lived here. They know where the spirit is of this land. If land is related to nature and nature to God, then they've got something to teach us about this place that we live in, the sacred spots. And they've got things to teach us about the animals and the plants, and they do. I mean, there's medicines, these plants, that a lot of the medicine people don't want to share with us. And one of the reasons why they don't want to is they're afraid Monsanto's going to come along and put a darn patent on it, you know, or something. So I don't know. I think they've got a lot, there's a lot to teach. And that's what my approach has been is with the book, is that he's talking almost like a psychologist, kind of psychology and spirituality kind of mixed in together. I think it's a really good message that he puts out there. It's not only these, you know, the four aspects of your life need to be balanced, but he uses the medicine wheel, which is, there's four quadrants, and very deep, many, many layers. He used that to teach. He turned 70 years old on the 14th of May, 2014, and he died on the 20th, 6 days later. And then he had another one of his healing lodges scheduled for the 10th of June. Very much looking forward to that, but it never happened. One of the most surprising things that happened when I started gathering all my material that I had on Larry, all his words and teachings, is that I ran across something that it doesn't surprise me that I did at all, is I asked him at an earlier date, 3 or 4 years before he died, when I first started realizing what a great teacher he was, is I asked him, can I write about this? You know, Because for an example, you don't shoot pictures during spiritual ceremonies on reservations with Indian people. So I wanted to ask, can I write about this? You know, can I write about your teachings, which many of them are very cultural, some of them spiritual. Can I write about this? And he wrote me back and he said, well, you know, if you think this will help people, go right ahead. And then I sent him three things that I had written about Ojibwe culture. And he wrote back and he said, wow, I've never read those before. I can't quote him exactly, but he said words to the effect that he really liked it and he thanked me for being the messenger of the teachings. So when I found that, I thought, well, hey, I can do this. I've got his permission, you know? And I kind of felt like I did. I could almost feel it, and that's in the foreword. One of the biggest problems I found was finding all this information that I had on him. I had emails from him. I had the stories that I'd written about him. I'd just taken notes. Sometimes he'd start talking about the wolf or something when the wolf hunt started, and he'd start talking about the wolf. And I'd start writing, and finally I bought myself a tape recorder because he'd say these far-out things. I asked his wife one time, I says, does he talk like this at home? She says, no, it just seems to flow from him when the time comes, when the time is right. He's just a very impressive person. He touched a lot of people, touched many more people than I'd ever imagined. But I had to put it together. And one of the other things, probably half the book, is made up of PowerPoint teachings. What Larry did was he took these teachings, and this includes the teachings of the seven grandfathers, which is seven virtues that he would talk about, and each is represented by an animal, and then of course balance in all parts of your life. Bringing that all together and then deciding how it ought to work together was a very, not tedious, because I found myself learning. I was feeling bad because he was gone and I wasn't being taught anymore. But as I went through these PowerPoints and all these stories that I'd written about him and all the stories that I found about him, and I even found some film that I transcribed, KTCA did. He was in the language revitalization, Ojibwe revitalization that KTCA did out of the Twin Cities Public Television. So I transcribed that as well. All putting that all together took me hours and hundreds of hours, I'm sure. I didn't try to document how long, but it took me a year of fairly regular working on it. When the book comes out, if folks would like to pick it up and read it, it was done by a local publisher called River Feet Press. He's got a Facebook page. He's also got a web page. And if you just put River Feet Press in your search engine, it'll come up. But it'll also be available on Kindle. It'll also be available from Amazon. And there'll be various bookstores that this publisher has got here in the city of Bemidji and all across northern Minnesota that handle his books. I see importance in the teachings that he had, and I see it even more now that he's gone, which is what happens oftentimes is you realize, oh wow, this guy was really a great teacher, you know, and you knew he was a good teacher at the time, but when he's gone, you realize, oh wow. And I'm hoping that people will get something out of it and make a better world, you know? I mean, you know, little by little, we all do our little part.
During the summer of 2016, my friend Darwin Sumner invited me to film him and a family with a foreign exchange student from Spain fishing at a pristine lake on the Red Lake Nation. So I drove from Bemidji up 89, past the casino, to meet Darwin and this family where they were purchasing their licenses. From the courthouse, we were off to a stocked lake deep in the forests of the Red Lake Nation.
Gotta move over that way, I gotta back the thing down there.
Darwin prepared his boat and the family for a morning on the water.
From Red Lake, Minnesota. My taxpayer name is Darwin Sumner from Red Lake. I'm a Hereditary Chief. I come into the Hereditary Chief last March when My father, John Sumner Sr., passed away, and I got to take over for him as eldest son. Last summer, we took a special young man named Joaquin fishing with us. Joaquin is from Spain, and we took him up to Red Lake and did some trout fishing. Ready?
Skipper.
Yep, ready to go.
Oh, it wasn't a skipper.
Is it plug in?
Huh?
The plug in? The boat? Did you put the plug in? Dude, you better reel it back in. We might. Just kidding.
So, my name is Joaquin González Iribarren. I was born in January 2002. My mom is Itziar Iribarren and my dad, Anulfo González. Last summer, I went to Minnesota as an exchange student, and I went fishing to Red Lake, and it was one of the best experiences of my whole life. I highly recommend it.
Where are you at? Where am I at? And how are we doing the interview?
So I'm in my house in Spain, in Madrid, and you are in Minnesota, and we are doing this via Skype, and we're recording this. So, you know, you can do interviews through all around the world.
People who want to come enjoy the great outdoors in Red Lake fishing, they have to be with a tribal member. The tribe has several guides that they hire, but the main, most important thing is you got to have a Red Lake member with you who's a registered guide with the tribe in order to go fishing. So bringing Joaquin up to Red Lake and him being from Spain, I figured, you know, we got a little part of the world up in Red Lake, you know, with our reservation, so it's just a little small part we got. And we want to share that with people, being no matter where they're from, you know, just kind of showing them around the res, showing some culture stuff and where we're at and who we are, do a little fishing, have a little fun, and share some stories with each other.
When they told me we were going to go fishing with Darwin and with his grandson, I was told so many stories about Dad, that he's so nice to kids, that he teaches very good to kids, and that he's a great person.
My experience with Joaquin was, you know, like with any other kid, you know, it's just kids are the same no matter where they're from, you know, they all want to have fun, learn stuff. So I brought my grandson along to help me out a little bit. You know, my grandson's name is Landon, and I taught him how to fish. And I asked Landon to teach Joaquin and the other guy how to cast, so when we're out there, we wouldn't have hooks flying around. But so Joaquin fit right in with us, and he took up the fishing, you know, no time, but I think he got the first one, actually. So
we're going to try to kind of change up some hooks out here.
We picked a good day. We couldn't have picked a better day to go fishing that day. It was sunny out and no bugs. Once you get out on the water, there's no bugs. And, you know, the wind picked up a little bit after a while because it was a little hot, but fish were biting really good. I think we caught like 30-some fish.
Look how clear that water is. You can see all the way down to the bottom still, guys.
Yeah, that's just beautiful.
Yeah. You have water that clear in Spain, Joaquin?
Nope.
I didn't think so.
To go fishing with my host family was a great experience. All those sights, it was a great thing, you know, that lake with clear waters and with all those trees around, and it was very nice with no buildings. You could see it wasn't air polluted, and it was very nice. Now with that experience, I got to know what pollution was doing to the forest near here and in Minnesota and everything, because I'm a Boy Scout and I get to go like one time each month to the mountains, and I know pollution is doing very bad things to our planet.
It's great. I love the lake. It's very, very nice, and I have a great opportunity to learn how to fish very well.
He got up there, we went in the woods, and he was saying, wow, I've never been way out in the woods like this. And it seems like he had a good time with the nature aspect of it. He was asking a lot of questions about the woods and the people and the land we're at. And he had a good respect for and knowledge of nature.
All those sites, it was very nice. I went fishing one time in the States, but I didn't catch anything.
Landon, what is it like to teach your new friend Joaquin how to fish?
very fun. And you're like my teacher now.
Yeah. Yeah, Landon did a good job with Henry and Joaquin. Joaquin was asking Landon a lot of questions as we were doing the whole filming, you know, and Landon was more than happy to share his 2 cents. Landon's been at it since he's been 2 years old, so. And I didn't teach him that. He just, one day I asked Landon, I said, who taught you that? He said, well, been watching TV. So he learns a lot from in fishermen and stuff like that. But he was really proud of himself for helping out Joaquin, you know, catch his first fish. And I was really proud of Landon, so. Like a grandpa should, right?
We're gonna try some butterworms. And if you could take that hook off of there, please.
We had Joaquin fishing for rainbow trout and brook trout. And it's very simple technique. It's just a plain tungsten smallest jig you can get with a little butterworm or waxworm on it and maybe some cut up earthworms. Yeah, and we were fishing pretty deep that day because it was kind of warm, and we started off shallow, but we found we weren't biting there, and we moved out to like 30 feet, and then we started getting, and we caught some nice ones that day.
Okay, reel.
Look out, Landon.
Reel.
Hey,
net landing, net landing, net landing. Wait, hold up a second. Not too fast. I'll tell you what. There you go. You're good. Okay.
This is a fish. Oh my God.
Hey!
Here we go!
Look at this fish!
Okay, hold on,
bail. Clip the bail.
Oh, yeah.
Good job! Look at me five!
Well, we get the camera out here. We gotta show your first fish.
When I first, felt that there was a fish in my hook, I thought, it can't be real.
Joaquin.
What?
Come over here.
Oh my God.
Come over here.
Hold it.
Come over here.
Over there by Darwin there.
Good work, you guys.
You think it will be more hard and everything, but it's very soft and you get to. And that way I started saying, rail. And I started doing, and when I got the first fish, it was going to be a very, very small fish, but I think it was the biggest one I ever caught.
So what's it feel like to have caught a fish?
It feels awesome.
What were you doing when you caught him?
Fishing.
Describe what you were doing.
I was just putting, getting up and down the fishing rod.
Jigging it, Bob.
Yeah, jigging.
Did a good job. You see how they kind of just hit and start reeling, and they pretty much hook themselves and they're coming out. Good job, Joaquin, and you're from Spain now?
Yeah.
What kind of fish they got in Spain?
Not much really. They in Madrid we don't have.
Oh, Madrid.
Yeah, I'm
wow,
from Madrid.
That's a pretty famous place.
Yeah.
Okay, let's try to get another one, shall we?
Joaquin caught a fish and he was all excited. You can see the kids, you know, they get all excited and they start really try to get that fish up as fast as they can. But you know, sometimes it doesn't work. You know, sometimes they fall off. But that's all about fishing.
See how slow that is? Okay, you kind of on the bottom. Right there. Then the boat moves and then we kind of get to different depths. So just leave the line right there.
But when Joaquin, I remember him saying wow, that's the biggest fish I've ever caught. You know, that's the first fish I've ever caught. So that kind of makes everybody feel good in the boat about helping somebody else learn how to catch a fish. Most times from my experience, once you get a kid fishing, he's hooked, you know. He's going to come back out and fish some more with us, so.
Oh. I seen that bite. Don't mess with that. Don't mess with it. Oh. Leave it right there. You had a bite while you were messing with it. There you go, reel. The big one?
Yeah.
Okay, easy. Just hold the rod right there. Hold it steady. Oh, that's a nice one.
Oh my God.
Okay, lift it up. Oh, sorry. Lift it up right here.
Oh, I cannot do
lift it up. Just lift it. Lift the rod up. But don't take it to the top.
Look at that one!
Don't.
Yeah.
Open the bail, please.
Yeah. Open up
the
line, the bail.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was a big one.
That's a nice one. Okay.
That's a rainbow trout.
That's a big rainbow trout.
teaching kids or anybody to fish, that's a skill they can carry for a lifetime, you know. But teaching kids, especially for me, is really important. So, you know, they can carry that on to when they have children, when they get to be young adults and have children, and they can teach their kids to fish.
That's a huge one, Joaquin.
Yep.
Okay. All right, put them back in and let them swim.
Goodbye.
Yeah, good job. Awesome.
To me, fishing, being on the water, it's really a like, spiritual aspect of it to me. Spending time out there, it just feels good. I think the better you feel about yourself and life, and that water really has that healing effect on you. And I've seen where kids actually feel a lot better after a time out on the water, you know. Kind of wears them out a little bit, but still, that fresh air is good for them. And a lot of times they go home and they just go right to sleep, but they're always talking about wanting to go fishing again. And the main thing is they're out there enjoying the outdoors, having a good time. And the spiritual aspect of it is, you know, what gets me out there. And just even catching a fish is just a bonus to get out there, you know. Once you learn a few simple techniques, presentations, whatever, you're on certain like bass, walleyes, crappies, you can pretty much go any place and catch them with the same techniques.
There you go, Joaquin. Good job, man. This guy's on fire. And you're from Spain. Okay. I like it. Just reel. Don't do anything fancy with the rod. That's a nice one. Now, when I say lift up, just lift up slow. Lift up slow. There you go. Good job. Yeah.
Thank you so much for watching. Join us again next time on Common Ground.
If you have an idea for a Common Ground piece that pertains to North Central Minnesota, email us at legacy@lptv.org or call us at 218-333-3014. To view any episode of Common Ground online, visit us at lptv.org. To order episodes or segments of Common Ground, call 218-333-3020. Common Ground is brought to you by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund with money from the vote of the people November 4th. If you enjoyed this episode of Lakeland Public Television's Common Ground, consider making a contribution at lptv.org.